Welcome back, and in this lesson I want to talk in a little bit of detail about fibre optic cables. If you're involved with networking in any way, then you need to be comfortable with how they work, their characteristics, and the differences between the various types. Now, this matters for the real world, and if you need to work with any physical networking services, including AWS Direct Connect. Now, let's just jump in and get started. Fibre optic cables are an alternative way to transmit data versus copper cables. Where copper cables use changes in electrical signals to transmit data over a copper medium, fibre optic cables use a thin glass or plastic core surrounded by various protective layers. The core is about the diameter of a human hair. The cable that you can see and touch is that core surrounded by a lot of protection. If you just handled the core on its own, it would be pretty susceptible to damage. Now, fibre optic cables, as the name suggests, transmit light over the glass or plastic medium. So light over glass or plastic versus electrical signals over copper. These unique elements mean that the cable can cover much larger distances and achieve much higher speeds versus copper. At the time of creating this lesson, this can be in the regions of terabits per second. Now, fibre is also resistant to electromagnetic interference, known as EMI, and it's less prone to being impacted by water ingress into a space where the cables are being used. In general, fibre offers a more consistent experience versus copper cable, and so in modern networks, specifically those which require higher speeds and/or larger distances, fibre is often preferred versus copper. You're going to see over time, fibre will gradually overtake copper in almost all wired networking situations as it becomes cheaper and easier to install. It's already used for many global networking, metro networking, and even many local area networking applications. So that's important to understand. It's going to be used more and more in the future. Now, in terms of physical makeup, this is what a typical fibre cable looks like externally. There are two different things that you need to think about, and this is common with any form of networking cable or any form of cable in general. There's the cable choice, which will influence the physical characteristics, so how fast data can be transferred and over what distances. Then you have the cable connectors, and these generally affect what the cable can be connected to, so linked to physical ports on the networking equipment, but they can also influence some of the physical characteristics in terms of distance ability and speeds. Now, I'm not going to detail all of the different fibre cable types in this lesson. Instead, I've included a link attached to this lesson which gives you a good overview of the common cable and connector types within the industry. Now, I want to spend a few minutes talking about the physical construction of fibre cables. I've talked about how the connectors are different, but it's important that you understand the different physical makeups of the cable itself. Now, when we're talking about fibre cable, you'll see it referred to using an X/Y notation. For example, 9/125. This defines two parts of the cable. The first part is the diameter of the core in microns, and the second part is the diameter of the cladding. That's the bit that surrounds the core. Both of these are in microns, and there are 1,000 microns in a millimeter. Now let's talk about the different components of a fibre cable, and I'm mainly going to be covering the fibre core, the fibre cladding, and the buffer. And don't worry, the functions of each of these will make sense in a second. Now, we're going to start with the core, and this is the part of the cable where the light is carried, which allows for the transfer of data. This part on a 9/125 cable is tiny. It's only 9 microns across. So if you look at the right of the screen, you have the core, then you have the transmit and receive optics at each side, and the light flows through the core along the length of the cable. I'll talk more about this in a moment, but the light doesn't flow in a straight line, it's actually bouncing off the inside edges of the core, which is why the size of the core matters. Now, surrounding the core is the cladding, and this is a material which has a lower refractive index versus the core, and this means that it acts as a container to keep the light bouncing around inside the core. Different types of fibre have different sizes of core and cladding, and both of them radically impact the physical characteristics of the cable. And this is where we move on to the less important parts of the cable. The core and cladding were directly responsible for the physical transmission of data, but now we're moving on to the protective elements. So next we have the buffer, and the buffer is the thing which adds strength to the cable. The core and cladding are generally really good at helping to carry data, but really bad at withstanding any physical shocks. The buffer is a combination of coating and strengthening materials, such as fibres made out of other materials. Now don't confuse this type of fibre with fibre optic, this is just lengths of other material which is designed to absorb shocks and give physical protection. And this buffer is surrounded by the cable jacket, which is the physical thing that you see when looking at a fibre cable. It generally has a defined colour such as green, orange or blue, and this generally gives some indication on the overall capabilities of the cable. Now I've included a link attached to this lesson which details the common colours and what they mean in terms of the fibre optic cable's capabilities. Now one more thing that I want to cover before we finish this lesson, and that's the difference between single mode and multimode fibre. The difference might seem pretty nuanced, but it's really important to understand. Let's start with single mode. Single mode generally has a really small core, and it's often 8 to 9 microns in size, and it generally uses a yellow jacket, but this isn't always the case. Now, because of this tiny core, light generally follows a fairly single and straight path down the core. There's generally very little bounce, and so very little distortion. Single mode fibre generally uses lasers, and so it's more expensive in terms of the optics versus multimode. Single mode, because of this lack of distortion, is great for long distances, and it can achieve excellent speeds over these long distances. Now, it's not the fastest type of fibre cable, but if you need a combination of high speeds and long distances, then it's by far the best. Single mode fibre can reach kilometres with no repeating or amplication, and can do really high speeds at those distances. Generally, in production usage, this is 10 gig and above. Single mode fibre cable itself is generally cheaper than multimode fibre, but the transceivers, so the things which send and receive light, are more expensive versus multimode. But this is changing over time, and this will probably mean more and more single mode usage within most business applications. Now, multimode cable generally has a much bigger core and often uses either an orange, an aqua, or other coloured jacket. Now, the bigger core means that it can be used with a wider range of wavelengths of light, generally at the same time. For simplicity, think of this as different colours of light travelling down the same fibre cable, so these different colours can be sent at the same time and don't interfere with each other. More light means more data, so multimode tends to be faster. But that comes with a trade-off, because this leads to more distortion over the light over longer distances. For that reason, multimode historically has been used for shorter cable runs, where speed and cost-effectiveness is required. Now, multimode generally has cheaper LED-based optics rather than the more expensive laser optics used within single-mode fibre. Multimode fibre cable will generally use the prefix OM, so OM2, OM3, OM4, and so on, each improving the previous one's capabilities. And multimode, as I mentioned before, has a larger core. At a high level, the type of cable you decide on is determined by the distances that you need to transmit data and the speed. So single mode is just more sturdy, there's less distortion, and it can do better speeds over higher distances. And as the optics price has come down, I suspect more people will use single mode even for shorter distances. Now, one final thing I want to cover before we finish up with this lesson, and that's fibre optic transceivers. Now, these are generally the things which you plug into networking equipment, which allows the networking equipment to connect to fibre optic cables. They're known as SFP transceiver modules, also known as SFP or mini GBICs, and this stands for single form factor pluggable. Now, these are the things which generate and send or receives light to and from the fibre optic cable. So these plug into networking equipment, these have optics inside which generate the light or can detect the light, and these are used to translate from data to light and from light to data that networking equipment can use. Now these transceivers are either multimode or single mode, and they're optimised for a specific cable type. So you generally buy a transceiver that's designed to be used with a certain type of cable, and the transceivers will need to be the same type on both sides or both ends of a fibre optic cable. Now, when you're talking about the connector type and the cable, you're generally going to see terms such as 1000 base LX, 10G base LR, or 100G base LR4. And these are often specified by vendors such as AWS to give you an idea on the type of cable and the connector that you need to use to plug into their equipment. So in the case of AWS Direct Connect, the supported types are 1000 base LX, 10G base LR, and 100G base LR4. Now, unless you're doing the advanced networking specialty level of study, you don't need to remember these from memory. If you are doing the advanced networking, I would recommend that you try to commit these to memory because it might help you gain an exam mark within the exam. Now at this point, that's everything I wanted to cover at a high level about fibre optic cables and transceivers, and once again I've included some links attached to this lesson which go into a little bit more detail if you're interested. At this point though, that's everything I wanted to cover, so go ahead and complete the video, and when you're ready, I'll look forward to you joining me in the next.